This is the lecture number 19 of the deep learning course. And in this session, we are going to talk about the CNNs. So CNN is, however, I'm going to teach this in this particular class first time, but it is mostly, I assume that it is not new to you. So let me show you that how you actually know what are the parts over there and what are the things that we have discussed in the previous class that can be connected with the things that we are going to see today. So I would start by showing you this particular diagram. This particular diagram actually talks about that if you want to make any computer vision system, what are the important small components that you need to build? So generally what happens that, let's assume that a simple problem of telling that there is an image, is there a dog or cat or not, okay? There is an image, we want to tell that classification problem that whether there exists a cat or there exists a dog. It is a very simple problem where I am going to provide input as an image, some image I am going to provide as an input. So generally what happens that every system has some kind of quality check into the system. If the images that I am going to have are of bad quality, definitely I am not going to do the things better. So if possible, sometime after quality check, it may be possible that I can send again signal to the input and ask that, can you provide me another signal? This is the one thing, that quality checking. If it is rejected, then I am going to be here. Otherwise, I would go here. What is the next step? That if some image is given to you, you want to enhance it. What do I mean by enhancement? Sometime enhancement is not only the improving the quality, sometime making the things to be suitable for the further processing. For example, if it's a very the image has been taken from a very good quality, high resolution camera. Okay, so the size may be very large. And if you start doing the processing, it may take a very long time. For example, it is actually our case also. We have actually developed a system where there was a force lab. Have you heard about the force lab? So you know that there is a fingerprint scanner where you put your finger and it scans that what it generates an image of that particular finger. So force lab are a special kind of scanners where you can put all four fingers at the place. So, however, I have seen this first when I went for the visa to the US. So, if you have experienced that, it is a special kind of device. So the surface is only large and you put all four images over there. So, this kind of image actually comes to you. So, this kind of image comes to you. If it is a bad quality, I would keep taking in the things, because why the bad quality image could come? Because if you are not putting the right pressure, okay, then the image would not come. So the system would, he would reject that thing and ask that, okay, keep the pressure. And sometimes if you have gone there, they'd say that press it like that. However, it is not needed. But let's assume that you got the good images. What is the size of this image? Generally very large, 1080 multiplied by 1080. Okay. Number of pixels, if you just multiply this, let me just take this as a 1000. So it becomes this much number of pixels to do the processing. It takes so much time to do the processing that, and what is the processing I want to do? Let's assume that the processing that I wanted to do is to cut this particular part. Because if you take the image, ultimately you have to extract the features, extract the fingers to do the processing. So you know that this is what the finger is. Okay, generally finger is like that. Only top part has a fingerprint. Other part does not have the fingerprint. If you see this, you can very clearly understand that there is a difference. If you see the upper part, there would be and other things, but lower part does not have those kind of things. Okay, the finger has three parts, but these things does not have the good structure. So this part you have to cut. Let's assume that this is my task. I want to cut that particular part. So ultimately, your objective would be to tell that. Let me tell you, tell that what is this coordinate and what is this coordinate. If I can tell these two coordinates, I'm done, because I can make a box, I can cut that thing. To find out these four values, for example, here how many? So four fingers, so 2, 4 multiplied by 2, 8 values. I have 2, 8 multiplied by 2 because XY coordinate. I have to only find out the 16 value and how many values I'm processing, this much. Is it not too much? Can I reduce something? So the idea is this, if I reduce this size, for example, by 1 by 10 by 1 by 10, doing some kind of sampling that we have discussed in the last class, so the size would be only 100, for example, if I divide this maybe by, say, say 10 times onto the x-axis and 10 times into the y-axis. I have actually put the marker at wrong place. So if I say that I divide by 10, so then this number becomes 1/100. 1/100 is 100 times faster. In the time you were processing one fingerprint image, now you can process 100. And even the size is not going to be that bad, because ultimately you are not going to utilize this thing anymore. You just only want to give me these 16 numbers. So these 16 numbers can be generated out of that. So this idea where I'm going to tell that I'm going to reduce the size, or another thing that I can do, that this image may have three channels, okay, RGB. Why do I need RGB? All these values, because I have to tell the coordinates, they are not related to the RGB. So if I reduce that to one value, how can I reduce? Maybe the one method could be that pixel by average I can take and put it here. However, there are better method that tells that RGB can be, there could be a weighting, and weighting could may not be the same weighting, because if I say that averaging means the weight is 0.33. okay, so the other method says, I'm not right now aware about the current values, but they are changed. Maybe this value could be 0.25, 0.5, 0.25. So these are the different values. With a different value, I can create this. It is a better visible image. So one thing, if I do like this, then again this particular size is going to be divided by 3. Okay, so 300 times I have made my system fast. So these things can be, this thing also comes into the enhancement. Also, sometimes what happens, that it is really very important thing. Let me tell you that what happens, that in this particular example also, what was happening, that some of the images, sometimes what happens, another person puts the image. Let me tell you that we have talked about the histogram equalization, and there was an image that in which you are barely able to understand anything. It was very dark. But when we have done the histogram equalization, we saw that a lot of things were there. Similar thing happens here also. When you are going to, as I'm telling that, when you are putting your fingers, your screen may not be show you that what is over there, because the values are very less. You are not pressing much. If you are pressing, then the more visible pattern would come on the screen. But still, when you are touching that thing, the things are there, but they are not visible. So what we can do, if we can do the histogram equalization on that, because what would happen, that if let's assume all the values are there, those less values, these values are only visible over there. If we do a histogram equalization, those images where you cannot see anything, suddenly their fingerprint appears. So this is a real case that we have actually done on that. So we have collected a database of nearly 24,000 images from the rural background, and we have developed a system. You can find out that paper. So the enhancement, this is part of the enhancement, that you have improved this thing so that these things can be better onto the next state. After this, if you want to do something, you have to find out the right kind of feature. There could be multiple ways to find out the feature. And for example, shift, surf, and you are also doing these things these days as a class project. So various feature extraction methods are there. Based on the requirement, if it is this image has come for the registration, then you put into the database. Otherwise, you extract the related things from the database and do a matching. And after that, you decide that if the score is higher, then you say that there exists a cat or not exist a cat, or whatever you can decide. What is the important point? Important point is this, that there could be multiple ways of enhancement, not only single ways. Say E1, E2, E3, E4. There are multiple ways of feature extraction, shift, surf, ORB, multiple things, F1, F2, F3, F4. There are various ways of matching, Euclidean distance, cosine distance, Mahalanobis distance, well, various ways. So D1, D2, D3, D4, various ways. And then decision is not that thing. Maybe you can directly apply and find out the probability. So if we see from this initial point and go till end, there could be multiple path. Let me tell you what. So let us say that quality check is okay. Then one path could be that you are using the E1 and F1 and A1. And there could be you are using this enhancement, this feature extraction, this method. Another method could be this. Lot of method, a lot of different paths are possible. Understand? If we somehow understand that there exists a network, enhancement network, and there exists a feature extraction network, there exists a matching network. Let's assume that these are the different networks. And if we change the parameter over here, so the feature extraction changes. If we change the parameter of the enhancement, the network changes. It does a different kind of enhancement. So if we think from a very high level perspective as a modular development, we can put that there is an enhancement network, then there is a feature extraction network, then there is a matching network, then there is some decision part, maybe decision head, and we are providing the input as an input. What is the loss? And if we want to reduce that particular loss, is it possible? We can do like that. And if we develop the system in this particular way, where I'm telling that I'm not going to specify what are the parameters into this particular system, you from high level perspective can see that everything is a network. Everything from here to from starting to end, everything is a single network. And if you can come up with a parameter, definitely you can come up with a parameter using various kind of methods. So if you can come up with the right kind of parameter, then this thing, what is the enhancement it is going to do? I don't know, maybe a new kind of enhancement. What is the feature extraction it is going to do? Maybe a different kind of feature extraction that we were earlier talking about. What is this? This may be a different kind of matching strategy that we were using earlier. So, and this thing would be such that they can be combined in a very good way. So this is the power of deep learning, that if when you put all these things together, you need not to go and individually see that for every component, what is the right kind of feature, what right kind of technique is needed. The system by itself decide that what is the right kind of technique. So generally this is what I wanted to tell you, that generally this is what the general pipeline of a computer vision system. But when you are going to solve this problem with the help of deep learning, you would be able to amazed by seeing that you need not to do all these things by yourself. The system itself decide that what is the right feature, what is the right enhancement, what is the right matching, etc. So that's why this is a general notion. If you write a paper, if you do something, some kind of research, and you are telling that I have taken this particular image, and after that I have done this kind of enhancement, as we have discussed a few minutes back, that there are multiple components such as quality check, enhancement, feature extraction, matching, and decision. And we have also discussed that these things can be assumed as a separate part of the network and separate parts of the network. And we can devise the relevant network architecture for them. And then if we devise a loss function and we want to minimize this particular loss function, what would happen, that the system is going to perform better with respect to the input images, and the network architecture that comes up to you may be more gluable to each other, more suitable to each other. So I hope it is audible to everybody. We can continue. Okay. So as I told you, that various choices are there at each level, and when we use the deep learning, then the system automatically decides that what is the right thing. So this kind of method, this kind of mechanism is called end-to-end learning. Okay, we have a name for that. Very interesting thing that I am going to show you today, and maybe you are aware, but please listen this. So what happened, that computer vision community was actually facing very serious challenges with respect to the solving those kind of problems. Why it was happening? It was happening because when we want to develop a system, we collect some kind of examples. Those examples are very less, and also there is no correlation between the example, because let's assume that in a directory there are 100 images. What is the order of them? There is no order, because it's an alphabetical name order, and it doesn't make any sense, much sense, because name could be anything. So what you do generally, that you collect some kind of databases, image database. Let's assume that you want to do a classification whether there is a cat or dog. So you are going to collect cat and dog images, and then you are going to train a particular model and want to get the very high accuracy. Just try to see that. Just try to compare a 3 years old child. Okay, 3 year old child, he is seeing the object from very close. Okay, in 1 second, he sees 25 images, or frame rate is around 25. in 1 minute he sees these many number of images. In 1 hour he says this was 1 minute, and then we can say that this is one hour, this is 1 day, this is 365 days, and then if he is 3 years old, we can say that there's going to be this many number of images he is going to see. This is a huge number. That's why even 3 years old, who is not very much cognizant, you can see that he has seen these many number of images. Let's assume that 5 years old child, he can tell many things to you, that where there is a banana, where there is a car, he can tell all these things. These many numbers of images he have seen. But if we see our databases, our example, they are very less. 2,000 images, 5,000 images, 5 lakhs images. So they are very less as compared to this particular number. So assuming anything very good from the system without giving him a lot of opportunity to learn is actually not that good. So people had thought that why not to collect a lot of data. So one such effort was done by a community, and the database that they collected is called the ImageNet database. Okay. This database has 4 million images that they all were collected from the internet sources, and they contains 21,841 categories. What do I mean by category? That given an image, you want to tell that what is inside this. So in the image, there could be a elephant, there could be a mouse, there could be a tree, there could be a car, there could be a bus, there could be a scooter, a banana, anything. So how many different objects were there? 21,841 objects were there. So it was a big database, the first crowd project, where the people were sitting on the images, and they were telling on the image. The 4 million images were collected, and images were distributed to the people. People have seen those, and they have marked that, they have manually written that what are the things into that particular image. So one image may contain multiple things also. It may be possible. Multiple things are also. For example, if you just consider this particular image, so what you can tell? That there is a scooter, there is a lady, there is a boy, there is some car, there is some road, multiple things are there. So multiple things are there. So this was a database, that big database was created, but people had realized that looks like that initially solving the problem that I can identify all these things at a go may not be the good thing. So they have come up with a subset of this database that contains only 1,000 categories. And thrown a challenge to the community that can you solve this particular problem, that what is my accuracy, can you increase the accuracy, tell me the accuracy. This is a very interesting diagram, let me tell you. Okay, please focus on this is a really, really very important diagram. The challenge was thrown around 2009, and in 2010 the method that came was actually they were using handcrafted methods such as SVM and other feature extraction methods, and their error was at 28%. So accuracy was 100 minus this value. So they were doing error on the 28% of the images. Next year, something changed. Different method came, and the accuracy error reduced to the 26%. So how much it was reduction? 2% of the reduction. Suddenly, next year, 2012, AlexNet has came. And AlexNet was, as I discussed into the previous classes, it is they were inspired by the previous work that happened in 1998 for the digit recognition. So earlier at that time, it was not possible to train the network, but by this time, they were actually able to see that the things are actually reviving. Why? There was some very good work has been done into the voice domain, that means voice-based recognition system. Again, the neural network were actually showing that their potential. In between, there was, as I also discussed about it, there was a paper that actually talks about that the automatic finding out the parameter is a better way to find out the parameter. So some notion was there that now we are progressing and we can find out the right parameter using deep learning kind of setting. So he have utilized the same thing that was used on NIST, NIST, MNIST, sorry, I'm sorry, the on MNIST, okay, on MNIST database. A similar kind of architecture, and he have trained on this particular data. He have used 8 layers. Generally, when you develop a neural network, generally 4 layers are too much. Okay, at that time, people were thinking that when they were developing hidden layer, 4 hidden layers are actually too much. But this network architecture was using 8 layers. So when the network was trained, they were able to reduce this error from 26% to 16%. It was a big thing. Okay, because you can see that earlier, if what you expect, that in 1 year you are able to reduce 2%, next year also you would be able to reduce 2%. But you are reducing 10% means something significant has happened. Okay, something very significant has happened, very radical has happened. Because this particular architecture was the first time introduced, so they have done something and introduced this particular model. But it was possible that if they have done the things into perfect way, they may have reduced this error to the 12%. Okay, their own network, if they have changed the right parameter, they have placed the layers at the right places, put the filter size, right filter size, then the same architecture could achieve 12% of the error. Okay, so this is called the ZFNet. It was just an improvement on the previous thing that was actually that AlexNet had proposed. So this is another very good architecture. But architecture wise, it was not a change. What was the change? That how you can tweak the model, how can you start better, and how you can get the better result. So this is the another thing. Next year, this was the breakthrough, 12%. And when you got this kind of things, definitely you would start thinking something radical. What would you start thinking? And right now, after ZFNet, what I just now told, that AlexNet was the first architecture. AlexNet was the first architecture. ZFNet was the improvement on this. And after the improvement, yeah. Okay. So when you come up these two things, what comes to your mind? If you want to increase this thing, just give me any wild guess. This was an 8-layer thing. And if you want to improve further, what you should do? Add more layers. Because you have seen that earlier 4-layer we were using and we were getting lesser accuracies, and this was using 8 layers. So why not you increase the number of layers? VGG, 19 layers architecture. Very difficult to train, but if there is a big company, they have a lot of resources, they can deploy it and find out the better architecture. This is the first thing that they have done. They have introduced more layers. They have also done architectural changes, but from very high level perspective, you can think that increase the layers to get the accuracy. And the accuracy was, and the error reduces to 7.3%. Next, what would you do? If you think that, okay, accuracy is now increasing, what you should do again? So the next idea is this, that you know that what was good with the David Lowe paper, that was SIFT paper. SIFT came around 2004. At that time, as I told you, that around 2000-2001, people were thinking that these methods, automatic methods or neural network based method, are not working. We should see the things from the handcrafted manual way. So David Lowe has introduced the concept that you should see the things from the different zoom level, different scales. You should see the thing from the different scales. Because when the person is taking the image, maybe taking the image from very near, maybe taking the image from very, very far. So you should take the things from very different zoom levels, okay, different scales. So if you see the things at the different scale, his accuracy was very good around in 2004. So definitely you would start thinking here also that I have only increased the things till using only layers. Why not we also see the things from the different zoom levels, different scales. So Google LeNet, what actually was the first architecture, they try to see the things at the various levels. Okay, same image has been reduced to the different sizes and using different sizes. So once again, let me draw here. So one image, it has been shortened, it even shortened, and then all these features are actually made as a single feature. And then you devise a system that actually gives you a better accuracy. Error reduces from 7.23 to 6.7%. Okay. Let me tell you that we are going to study these models in more details. Okay, at that time more things would come, because only just whatever I am telling, that only one thing using is not going to give you this much improvement into the system. Other things are also there. For example, when I use 22 layers, then training 22 layers becomes very, very difficult. And if I say that, see the things on the multiple layers, it means that you are increasing the input at every layer. Then the number of parameter even increases very large. How to deal with that? So one class one convolution were introduced by them. We would also see that at some later point of time. So these two network architectural changes that you have actually understood. Okay, you can now appreciate these methods. What was the first thing? Start with the neural network, improve that thing. Okay, deep neural network, improve that thing. Then we have seen that, increase the number of layer. Then we have seen that, see the things at the different layer. Now what you can do? Don't see this. Apne aap se batao. What you can do? Ab kya kar sakte hain? इंक्रीज मोर अपर, तो वो वही बात होगी ना, बकवास की हो जाएगा, बहुत मेहनत लगेगा, कुछ और करना पड़ेगा, कम करना पड़ेगा. मोर पैरामीटर इज गोइंग टू गिव अस मोर प्रॉब्लम ओनली. क्या करें? ये गलत बात है. इसलिए क्योंकि आप जो है जान रहे हो नेटवर्क और उसके बारे में बताने की कोशिश कर रहे हो. डोंट डू दिस. ओके, मैं इस क्वेश्चन को पूछ ही इसलिए रहा हूँ क्योंकि मुझे पता है कि बहुत सारी जगहों से आपने पढ़ लिया होगा, बट देर आर सम प्रॉब्लम जो आपको समझ में आता है कि नहीं आता है, वो समझना जरूरी है. ओके, स्किप कनेक्शन तो आपने बोल दिया, इससे खत्म हो जाता है सब मामला ही, लेकिन अभी समझना है. अभी यहाँ पे रहो और इसके बाद मुझे बताओ क्या करना है. हाँ, आप करें प्रीटेंड नेटवर्क यूज कर सकते हैं. सो अगला आइडिया ये है कि भाई 20 लेयर, हर कोई तो लेयर बढ़ा रहा है, पता नहीं कितनी लेयर की जरूरत है, मेरे को पता नहीं है, है ना. कहीं 8 लेयर कहते हो, कभी 19 लेयर, कभी 22, बहुत सारे लेयर बताते हो. तो मैं कह रहा हूँ कि अगर मान लो मेरी प्रॉब्लम के लिए 40 लेयर्स काम करता है, आई डोंट नो, मान लो लेट्स अज्यूम 40 लेयर काम करता है, और अगर मैं 80 लेयर लगा दूं तो क्या होगा? अरे भाई, मान लो कि 40 लेयर्स में काम करता है और 80 लेयर लगा देने का मतलब 80 लेयर्स, मतलब कुछ और लेयर बढ़ा दी, यही तो मेरा ये कहना है कि अगर And I believe that network is very good. So what the network would do? It would make this thing 0, 1. Network, let's assume that my network can learn. Ye toh humara pehla understanding hai na? My network can learn. If my network can learn, toh what would it do? It would make all these things as one. If my network can give me the best accuracy at 40, if I put 80 layers, means what? The 40 layer would be trained by the network because my network is good. And all other things become identical so that every value is passed like that, because if I have make a network, they can pass everything which has come earlier. So the network accuracy would be good. And now the important thing is that this is a general network. If there is something where 60 layers are, you need to be used, I can use this 80 layer one. If somewhere where there is 92 layers are needed, then I cannot use, but till 80 layers, I am okay. And when I have to put all the burden to the machine, who is stopping me to have it 80? I would take 152 layers. I would say, I'm going to take 152 layers and ask the computer to train. Ask the machine to train. Machine is going to find out the right parameter. This is a very simple idea. Nahi? Jaise bachcho ka idea hai. Bilkul bachcho ka idea hai. Ki bhai ye agar 10 layer mein kaam karta hai, toh 50 layer laga do. Definitely it is going to work. This is the idea of the ResNet. ResNet says that I am going to put too much layers and my system is going to work. This is what the idea is. Okay. In this idea, there was a problem. When they tried to implement this idea, there was a problem. And the problem was this. They were thinking that systems would work in this way. The system was not working. Not the overfitting. It was not able to find out the right parameter. I would not like to go into that particular detail. I don't want to tell that particular problem right now, so that you should be curious, and when the things would come, you talk in more detail at that particular time. There is very specific problem that comes with this kind of architecture. they were thinking that we should find out the parameter, but the system was not able to find out the parameter. Okay, let me give you some idea. I will not tell you complete thing. That let's assume that there is a range of number from 0 to 1. All the real numbers are possible. What is the, and there is a number 0.5. Okay, what is the probability that if I say that randomly pick a number, give me the 0.5, what is the probability? Zero. The probability is zero. I wanted this value to be 1, but what is the probability I'm getting that value? Zero. Value is possible, but the probability is zero. What to do? Similar kind of things are there. Okay. So, but the idea is not bad. So similarly, you can come up with the idea. If you come up with any kind of this philosophical idea that actually can work, definitely they have the merit. How to do that is a different kind of thing. So how they have done, we will discuss later. So this was a very good network, and this network has reduced the error from 6.7% to 3.6%. Even human can have error. For example, if I show this image and I ask you that what is there, and for example, this image. So maybe it is not fully visible. Sometime it may be, if the image is taken into the dark, you don't know that what is over there. There may be possible. Even the humans have the error. If the system becomes better than the human, this particular system becomes better than the human, then we stop over here. We think that the system is overfitting and we should not train more than this. We have achieved our goal. Ensemble means using multiple techniques, and you are combining different things. For example, ResNet, GoogleNet, EGG, all of them you are going to combine and do something else. And then error is further reduced. SENet error is further reduced, but people are not talking about much about this. And then they have moved to the better, more complex and challenging problems to their domain. So this is a very important diagram. Okay. So this is some of the images taken from the ImageNet Challenge database. And this is how the deep learning has actually evolved. Very important diagram. Okay. Why the layers works actually? When we develop these kind of layer, why these layers work? The important idea is this, that actually whenever we are stuck, we go and see that what is happening into the human system. So human system also have the similar kind of idea. Okay. So if there is some object in front of your eyes, you find out some feature that into medical domain, they say the V1 feature, then out of these V1 feature, they create V2 feature, then V2 feature create V4 feature, then IT posterior, IT anterior. I'm not sure about that. I'm not that much expert of this, but that is fine, because we only have to understand that things are going to happen with by layer. It happens into the similar way in our brain also. We have seen that whenever we are going to develop a computer vision based system, we have seen earlier also that the challenge for the computer is this, that we can make some sense that what is over there, but the computer cannot, because they see it as a number. So we have to move towards the feature instead of the using the actual values. We should move toward the features. Feature is going to tell that what is over here. The actual values cannot tell that what is over there. Whenever we are going to develop these kind of system, we may have to deal with the occlusion. Things are not shown. Only part is visible. Some part is hidden. Viewpoint variation, seeing the things from the different viewpoints. Scale variation, sometimes the thing item is big, sometimes item is small. Illumination change variations, deformations, background clutter, noise, intra-class variation, and much more. Many different kind of things are. That's why these problems are challenging. And using the deep learning, we have seen that it builds the hierarchy of the feature. What do I mean by this? That whenever you are going to provide some input, actually the first layer gives you something like this. After the first layer, you find out a representation. Next layer gives you another representation. It is another function. Because something was input, it was another function. Function of function of function. So you can see that a lot of non-linearity you can introduce into the system. And these things you can relate by this, by saying that, for example, the first thing is finding out the shift feature. Next thing is applying the k-means. Next thing, apply the feature pooling. Next thing could be the classifier. So you can think in that way. We have discussed earlier that all these things which are over there, you can think that they are one by one applied different kind of technique. This is a very simple example where one image has, this is taken from the book itself, that this is an image of a scholar, and at the very high level pixel values you can see. But when you combine these things at the and go to the upper layer, you may be seeing the edge. Where are the lines? Where are the edges? and then upper layer may combine these edges and lines and come up with some kind of parts, small parts. For example, if there is a car, you can create that there is some tire, there is some wind sheet, kind of that. And then next layer may further improve that understanding and make the completely may combine those kind of parts and make that cat, dog, or whatever. And after that, you can apply a classification head that can tell you that what the object over there. This is a very interesting paper, and ECCV 2014 paper, Visualizing and Understanding CNNs. You just search for this very interesting paper. That actually tries to show you that whatever the value that I'm going to get, how can I interpret it? So he tried to give the interpretation. At the first layer, he had trained a 5-layer network only and try to see that what are the things over there. So the same thing that we have discussed has been verified over there. So initially it was going to get something like this. And when he related this to the original thing, that this kind of things has appeared. At the layer two, these kind of features were actually generated. They are related to these kind of objects. You can see that here, you can see that some circles are there, some lines are there, some pattern, texture patterns are there. They are actually being captured. At the third layer, these kind of features you generate, then here you can see that they are related to the parts of the car and some, for example, there is a person, there is a foot only, and some portions, some small portions, they are going to be linked. Next layer, fourth layer, it is going to combine and make the bigger size things. Fifth layer, the complete object has been created. Okay. Complete car has been created, complete things are created. Okay, so this is the important paper that you just see that what is the meaning of the different kind of architecture that we are going to see. Next thing, I would stop at this particular point, but just let me give you the idea. These